Bienvenidos a Enfoque con Marcia Castillo. Una vez más, estamos preparándonos para esta nueva temporada que tenemos con el Señor y hoy está con nosotros el pastor Mark Bilts, que está desde el estado de Washington. Y él tiene mucho que compartir y mucho que decir, así es que estamos muy felices de tenerlo a él con nosotros y vamos a conversar ahora en inglés y pondremos los subtítulos en español y sé que usted va a ser grandemente bendecido. Amén. Pastor Mark, thank you so much for being with us. Welcome to Enfoque.
Oh, thank you for having me on your program. I'm just so glad you're out there proclaiming everything to the world like you are.
Yes, sir, we are. And today we have a very special program. We're going to be talking about what happens after the election. But before we dive into that question, tell me what you thought about the results of the election.
Well, I am so glad. It looks like there will be a sweep with not only the White House, they've got the Senate, and we're watching closely the House races. But he needs a clean sweep so he can get things done without fighting Congress. So I'm really hoping that he does have that.
Yeah, I was praying about our interview and the Lord brought something to my remembrance. You taught an ISO course on the prophetic calendar, and on there, I'm gonna tell you it is lesson, I don't remember the lesson number, but you talked about what happened when lawlessness was legalized during the time of Purim. Do you remember that?
Oh, I definitely remember teaching about that because in the book of Esther, we find they legalized drinking, legalized partying, legalizing doing all these things. They even would legalize killing people. And so total lawlessness, which is what happened in Noah's day as well. God said he's going to destroy the world because of violence. He says that twice. And the Hebrew word for violence is Hamas.
Incredible. I remember, and I actually I pulled the lesson because I don't think people realize what was happening in our nation with regards to the laws and everything that they were doing. You said on here, and I quote, that lawlessness was legalized, and it's about government getting out of control and calling that which is lawless lawful. And I think, well, not a, I don't think it's we know that this is the way that our nation was headed. And the fact that Donald Trump is able to work with the Senate and with the House of Representatives is a huge, it's a big deal. What do you think about that? What can you tell us about that?
Well, just like they legalize drugs as if that's going to make it okay, or they legalize abortion, or they legalize prostitution, or whatever they want to legalize, they think that makes it okay. Well, it doesn't make it okay. And so that's why I think that where we were headed, as you were saying, well, even now, they don't know the definition between legal and illegal. They don't know the definition between male and female. They can't even write a definition of anything.
When we spoke, the last time we spoke, you said that we needed to pray for a reprieve. And I think we got that.
I
I
think so.
felt, right? I felt the day after the election when we saw that the map was practically red all over, I felt like the people of Israel on the day of Yom Kippur, when the high priest, the Kohen Gadol, comes out of the Holy of Holies and is like, yes, we got another year, we got God's favor. That's how I felt
I
that day, right?
love it. I love it. Exactly. And so I believe the reason why God did this, and this is totally God, is because we need a very strong person going into war. We are in a war cycle for the next several years. In Ecclesiastes, there's a time to be born, a time to die. a time to plant, a time to pluck. Well, much of the church is planting at plucking time and plucking at planting time because they don't know what time it is. And
Yes.
I'm telling you, we are entering not a time of peace, but a time of war. And can you imagine what would have happened if we would have had world wars going on with Kamala Harris in charge? It'd have been an absolute disaster. She can't even make a decision on anything. She's so wobbly trying to appease everybody.
Yeah.
So I'm glad that everyone in this cabinet seems to be strongly pro-Israel. But I'm telling you, Israel's been fighting a great war against Hamas, against Hezbollah. They still have to go over the head of the octopus, and they need to destroy their nuclear sites, their oil facilities, put it back in the Stone Age. Because over the next 2 years, Israel's going to have a major war take place from Iran and Syria and several places.
Yeah, I want to ask you about that as well. But before I go into that topic, in the lesson you said that the world believes that if a law is created, it makes something okay. And I would like our audience to understand how that works and the moral laws that we are to be governed by. This is why this election is so critical, isn't it, Ashin? And based on your teaching and God's calendar, I remember our previous conversation. You said that if the rapture didn't come now, we would have to wait until 2030 when another Shemitah cycle begins, correct?
Well, it's the tribulation. The tribulation. Now, if you're a pre-trib, that's great. If you're mid-trib, I don't care, or post-trib. But the tribulation has to start the beginning of a Shemitah cycle. So if it doesn't begin the fall of 2029, it can't begin until the fall of 2036. Exactly.
I remember you said that. And so people need to understand that a government that fears the Lord or that, at least acknowledges God, it's critical because we see that in our nation, all these laws were being put into place, but that doesn't make it lawful when we come to
Exactly.
the Lord's heart, right? Can you expound a little more on that?
Yes. So often, even believers try to justify things that they do because the government legalized it. Well, that doesn't make it right. That doesn't make it moral. We have to live by God's laws, to make it into His kingdom. His kingdom has to reign in you, and you are in His kingdom, so you have to obey His laws. And sometimes you have to disobey man's laws. It does say in the New Testament that we're to submit to the laws of a nation, but that's only if they are moral, or only if they are laws that coincide with the gospel or with the kingdom of God. But when they tell you to do something that is totally unlawful, saying it's okay, we have to rebel there.
Wow, moral law is higher than man-made law.
Exactly. 100%. 100%. Exactly.
I'm quoting your lesson. You're my teacher. This is really important for us to understand, because the impression I want to say is that if there's a law written for it, then it must be okay. And we need to submit to those laws. And I think America, I have to tell you, although we prayed a lot and we interceded and we asked for a reprieve, I was taken aback by the response of this nation during the elections. We have hope.
I love it. I love it. And when you look out the house map right now, you see red everywhere, these little splotches of blue. But I think the main public wants to go back to making America great again.
If we make America great again, we are providing a future for our children and our grandchildren. And I think that's something we need to have in our forefront. We cannot forget about that. It's not just about what's happening today, it's what's coming in the future. And if we don't do something about that
Right.
here and now, then 10 years from now, who knows if we would
Yeah.
even be a nation.
One thing I don't know, I can't say where in Spanish, the school curriculum is who it's published by. But I can tell you this, and this is something all of your Spanish listeners need to look into. The number one publishing company for all the school books in the universities, high schools, is out of London, and it's Pearson Publishing. Pearson Publishing, the reason we're seeing all these riots on college campuses is because Pearson Publishing is owned by Muslims. It is owned by Qatar. It's owned by Turkey. And they are putting all the anti-Semitism in the school textbooks. Qatar gave $2 billion just to Cornell University to promote Islam. And it's through all of the books, it's in their history books, it's in every textbook of your Spanish-speaking curriculum schools. If Pearson Publishing publish them, that is where all this anti-Semitism is coming from in the universities.
That's pretty amazing. And most people are not aware of these things. And I think one of the areas in which we need to correct, and I think the pulpits need to get involved in this area, because we've been too comfortable with the separation of church and state.
Right.
And a lot of people think, I'm not getting involved in politics. And I'm reading from your lesson here. It says, if we choose not to get involved in politics, we will simply hand things over to them, their agenda, their what.
And they're teaching your kids. They're the ones who are teaching your kids.
So this is a calling, so to speak, for the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ to rise up and get involved and try to fill these positions. We had
Yes, the school
people
boards.
come into our church, and maybe some people get turned off by that. We had politicians come. We had people that were getting involved in the school board that were Christians.
That's right. Yay.
We need to vote for these people.
Exactly. Absolutely. Where is your church located?
In Miami, Florida.
You're in Miami. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, that is so important to get involved with the school board.
We had a, and actually, she was elected in our district to be a part of the school board and a representative. My husband is very involved with the school board when it's time to go and vote once a year, because you know what they're trying to do down here? They want to institute the month of, I think it's the month of October, the entire month to teach a transgender curriculum in the schools. So we had to fight back. It's not just about prayer.
Yeah.
We need to get involved. So we got the church involved and we went to the hearing that they had when the day that they were voting, and it was a fierce battle, Pastor Mark.
Did you win?
We won. She was
Yay.
reelected. Yes, she was reelected. But we need to bring awareness. And I think we need to tear down this taboo that we're dealing with in the church of, oh, no,
Yeah.
the separation of church and state. We cannot get involved in politics. It's too dirty.
Yeah.
I think that's a huge mistake.
Well, I think it would have been a big mistake if Mordecai and Esther weren't involved in politics.
You talked earlier in our previous podcast about getting involved. You talked about Mordecai, but we also talked about Moses.
Yeah.
He went in front,
Exactly.
he had to deal with Pharaoh. And who was Pharaoh?
Exactly.
A politician. A
Right.
politician who lied and said, yeah, I'm gonna let your people go. And then he changed his mind and he said, no, I decided not to. So, I think
That's a politician.
that's a politician right there, right? I think it's crucial, and we have this window, this reprieve, like you called it, and we went to war with that word that you gave us in the podcast, and the intercessors prayed and prayed and prayed. But I don't think we can sit back and relax during this time.
Not at all. Now's the time to go to war. We are entering a season of war. And I believe we're at the season of the greatest harvest in human history. But you don't get revival in the peacetime, you get it in wartime. And so I really believe the next several years, God is going to be breaking up the fallow ground, bringing war so that he can reap a big harvest by the end of 2029.
So what happens after the election?
Well, I believe that the left and terrorists are going to be bringing all kinds of attacks here in the homeland. Well, we may even have to issue martial law. I think there will be, you're going to see terrorist attacks, I believe, over the next several months as before Trump is elected. And it's going to be a lot of uprisings by the left, like the Black Lives Matter and all of these other terrorist organizations. So it'll be very interesting. But this is why we have to be prepared to battle. But the problem is the church doesn't understand the armor of God. The armor of God is not a Roman soldier costume. They hated the Romans. The armor of God is the priestly garments. Where it says we don't fight against flesh and blood, so why do we put on armor that's a Roman armor and kill each other with so much friendly fire? It's because it's not a Roman soldier costume. It is the armor of the priestly garments. The breastplate of righteousness is Aaron's breastplate. The helmet of salvation is Yeshua. It says in Isaiah before Rome was ever built that Yeshua is our helmet of salvation. And it's the word of God is his shield, and the sword is the word of God. So people have this wrong imagination, and they don't really understand spiritual warfare.
Tell me a little more about that.
Yeah, the feet are shod with the perspiration of the gospel of peace. They always put Roman soldier boots on. You were not allowed to have shoes on in the temple. You had to be barefoot because it was holy ground. The entire image is completely wrong. And I have a whole teaching on my website about the armor of God, proving that it is the priestly garments, not a Roman soldier costume. And so the church doesn't know how to fight correctly because they put on, just like David. David put on Saul's armor and he goes, "This isn't going to work." And so he takes off, okay, and he kills Goliath. The church is operating with Saul's armor, not God's.
Wow, that is so powerful. Now you're giving me homework.
Well, the other thing many people don't understand is the book of Ruth. Ruth is a prophecy. If you remember, there was Ruth and Orpah.
Yes.
And do you remember what Ruth's name means? Ruth is friend. Oh, you read, I
I
had that
read
in
it.
the book. What did you think of that?
This is the second time I'm reading your book. This is a book, it's a guide for this time. I highly recommend it. You talk about all of these things here, and I have a couple of questions. I won't keep you too long because I know you're very
That's
busy,
fine.
but tell us a little bit more about Ruth and Orpah.
Well, Orpah means to turn your back on. Ruth
Yes.
and Orpah represent the Gentile church grafted into Israel.
Yes.
But when the time comes, Orpah turns her back on Israel and goes back to her pagan gods, it says. But Ruth, which means friend, befriends Israel, works the harvest, and what comes forth? King David. Okay. Well, people don't know, but Orpah, her descendant was Goliath. And so in the last days, there's a big divide between the woke church and the awakened church. And it's the battle between David and Goliath. So there's a big war coming to the body of Messiah between those who are going to befriend Israel, work the harvest, Passover to Pentecost, and bring in the Messiah versus those who will go back to their pagan God in a one world church.
This is so powerful. A lot of people are asking, what's going to happen? Well, you want to read and find out what's going to happen? You have to read this book. You talk about in pages, let me see, I marked it because I've been studying and praying about what we were going to talk about. You say in page 125, I believe that What is coming over the next 2 years will not be the war of Gog and Magog, but the Psalm
Right.
83 and Isaiah 17 war. And that will carry us to 2026.
2029 almost. But I think here's what's interesting. If you look at page 124, I am the only one in the whole world that said Iran would attack Israel in April. And
Yes.
this was a year before. No one said that. And I
Yes.
showed that to one of the Knesset members in Israel, Ohad Tal, and he's in charge of like the military. He was blown away, wanted to know how I knew that. And I said, it's in the book of Daniel, chapter 10. That's how I knew. And but yes, I think the Isaiah 17 war, where Damascus is going to be destroyed, that hasn't been fulfilled. I think that is next. And I also think the Psalm 83 war, and then comes the Gog Magog war, will be at the end of the 7-year tribulation.
Correct. So the church needs to really prepare, strengthen, study, pray, and get together and decide, am I going to be a part of the woke church or am I going to be a part of the holy remnant?
Well, yes, exactly. And the key way is get on God's calendar. We are worshiping a solar calendar. All of our religious holidays are on the solar calendar when God said, no, I'm not using a solar calendar. I'm not using the Muslim lunar calendar. I'm using a calendar based on the sun and the moon. That's the biblical calendar because that's when you see eclipses, and he created them for signs. And he created the calendar 2 days before he created us, which tells you we needed the calendar. The calendar was created 2 days before us. We were the sixth day. And so God, like a parent preparing the nursery, wanted to prepare us to have a relationship with him. I can't have a Zoom meeting with you with a 3-hour time difference unless we agree on what calendar. You cannot have a dynamic relationship with God unless you meet with him when he says to meet with him.
Wow. And I'm going to have to admit that the church is not there yet.
That's why Easter is a month before Passover. How can they celebrate the resurrection a month before he dies? It's because they have it on a solar calendar, submitting to the Catholic Church. This is a total submission to the Catholic Church as being your authority.
This is critical. And I've been teaching about the Lord's calendar for many years now, but sometimes I find like a resistance. It's
Sure.
like people don't really wanna change. People resist change.
Oh, they absolutely do, but I don't know if they want to miss the boat like Noah's Ark. If you weren't there on the right day and you missed the boat, well, you have to pay the consequence. And so people, it comes down to they don't want to be under God's authority. Do you know right now in the Catholic Church, and I was Catholic when I was raised, there are two big divisions in Catholicism. You have your Eastern Orthodox, the Greek Orthodox, and you have the Roman Catholics. And the big division came over when to celebrate Easter. Okay, the Roman Catholics wanted on December 25th. The Eastern Orthodox wanted on January 6th. And there was an article. They are both ready to completely unite. Everything is resolved except Easter. Okay, which is, they're both wrong. They're both wrong. And here they're arguing over who's right. It comes down to who's going to be in authority. Well, that's why God says he's in authority and you got to be on his calendar. They don't realize it says that Nisan 14 is Passover, but they don't want to be under the authority of the Jews. So they create a whole new calendar, a whole new system. But that's why believers, they need to do what God wants. I mean, your boss, do you tell your boss when you want to come into work, or does your boss tell you when to come into work?
Correct, correct. I pray that, after the election, yes, I was very grateful for the results, but I tend to look beyond, what's ahead, what's in the future, and I worry sometimes that the church is going to say, okay, we're done. He's Donald Trump is in the White House, and I don't see it like that. I don't perceive it in my spirit like
Right.
that. I believe that this was only the first step,
Yes.
and then now we're gonna have to really go to war until
Exactly. Exactly.
he takes that oath again in
Yep.
January.
Yep.
And then if the Lord spared his life and
Twice.
he is twice and he is reelected, which is an amazing feat in itself, there has to be a reason.
A purpose.
I think the Lord is saying, I need someone that's really strong, that's not afraid of anybody or what anybody
Exactly.
thinks, in
Exactly.
order to bring about what I need to do on the earth. Do you agree with that?
100, 300%. And I believe, but now we don't sit down and let the general do everything. We're the troops. We're the ones that have to go get involved in spiritual warfare and be ready because I can tell you, God put him there because war is coming over the next 2 years. And that's why I want people to get the book. Oh, and I have great news. It's now available as a digital download. And it's Amazon Books and Kindle Books. Look like they're from the Flintstone age. When you see the America at War book as a digital download, so people all over the world can get it for free, no shipping, as far as the free shipping,
Right.
it's incredible. It is incredible as a digital. It works on phones. You can even read it on your phone, your iPad, your laptop.
We
Yeah.
need to promote this, and I'm praying that you would translate it to Espanol. I think it's an excellent book. It's a needed book. I think it will help people understand what's really happening in the spirit realm.
Oh, absolutely. Here's the other thing that I've just come out with that is mind blowing. It's not in Spanish, but what I've done, I don't know if you ever heard of Danny Ben-Gigi, but Danny
Yes.
Ben-Gigi is the number one Hebrew scholar, Hebrew teacher. No one in the world knows the Hebrew like he does. He's even taught at Arizona University Hebrew, but
Okay.
he knows the font that Moses used. He knows the font, that David used. He knows the Hebrew grammar inside, and just like English people need English teachers. He's the Hebrew teacher, even for the chief rabbi. He had to correct some of the chief rabbi's Hebrew. Okay.
Wow.
He and I got together, and we have the whole New Testament in Hebrew and English with the Hebrew transliteration and the phonics, so you can read Hebrew instantly. You can pronounce the Hebrew and you see all the translation errors. We've gone through the New Testament, and this is also like the other book. It's a digital where you go and you can turn the pages. It's just absolutely incredible. And we put audio so you can hear me correct the errors and why they're there. And it's in green. Every error is in green. We got rid of all the archaic English like travelust and siest. Okay. But the main thing, I don't know if your listeners are aware, but there are 9,000 different English translations.
Wow, 9,000.
So which one's right? Which one is accurate? Okay, we have found intentional mistranslations. Just like the media is biased, so were the translators. And so we have, well, we got, there's no churches anymore in the New Testament. They're assemblies, they're congregations, because the word church, what's the Greek word for church? Do you remember the Greek word?
Ecclesia.
But it never meant church. Never.
It was just a group of people that got together.
Yes, like a football game. It meant a secular assembly. A religious assembly was a synagogue, where you get the word synagogue
Synagogue.
from. So what happens in the Septuagint that was written 200 years before Jesus even came in Greek, the word ecclesia is all through it. But there was no churches 200 BC. The word is assembly. And so what in the King James in Acts 7, it says Moses was in the church in the wilderness. What do you mean? There was no church in 3500 BC. And so here's the thing. They changed the word church to ecclesia because they wanted to create something separate from Judaism. But in Acts chapter 19, they're all worshiping the great goddess Diana for 2 hours. And then in your Bible, it says, and then they dismiss the assembly. But the word is ecclesia. Oh, we can't put church there because they'll think the church was worshiping Diana. So now we're going to translate it correctly as assembly. And then in the book of James, it says, if someone comes into your assembly that is real rich, don't give them preference. The Hebrew word for assembly is synagoge. Oh, we don't want them to think they're meeting in a synagogue because it's all different. So now we're going to put assembly there. But then in Revelation, they talk about the synagogue of Satan.
That's
It's
right.
synagoge. How can they don't put assembly of Satan? Oh, now we want to equate synagogue with the Satan. And so they picked and chose English words that are totally incorrect.
Wow, that's incredible.
And so we correct, we have, this will be, I'm telling you, the most literally translated Bible in English for the whole 21st century. It is the most literal. Even if, just like the Spanish culture, if you're an American culture, there's things you're not going to understand in the Spanish culture. Well, the problem is we took the Hebrew culture and turned it into a Greek culture. When Peter denied Christ 3 times and the rooster crowed, never happened. It never happened. There never were chickens and roosters in Jerusalem. The chickens weren't acceptable for a sacrifice. And who want to smell a chicken slaughterhouse outside a temple that's outside? The word rooster was a title given to a priest. And there was a priest who would call out every morning 3 times for everyone to come begin the service. He was the rooster. So it wasn't a stupid rooster. It was the title given to one of the priests.
How incredible. But I think when you start learning about all these things, there's like a narrow path to truth. It
Yes, the
changes
narrow is
everything.
the gate. Narrow is the gate.
That's right. I think it's wonderful that you did that. I would like to get all that information so that I can post it on the
Yeah, it's
podcast.
just our website, esm.us.
Okay. I will do that. And there they can get the information on the Bible.
Well, if they can, but it's easier if they go esm.us/Bible. Then it goes right to it.
Okay. But we will put it on the scrolling message as
Yeah.
well here
Oh,
for
that would
people.
be great.
Yes,
Oh,
yes.
it is. It'll blow you away because there were other purposely mistranslated words. It's going to rock everyone's world. This Bible will.
What a blessing that you are doing this. I appreciate your ministry. I appreciate the mantle the Lord has given you. My husband and I, we have learned so much by listening to your teachings, your messages. I go into your website regularly also. And I encourage everyone that's listening to us today to do the same. And if you need translation, then we'll figure something out. But it's worth it. You have an amazing ministry, and the Lord has given you this beautiful way of teaching so that people can understand the Hebraic roots, which are our roots.
Exactly, 100%. Because you've been born from above. Everyone who's born from above is part of that fact, Abraham's family.
That's right. I think we need to accept that.
Yes,
I think we've
yes.
gotten to the point where we need to say, okay, enough. We're not Roman Catholics. We're not Greeks. We came from a Jewish womb.
Exactly.
And so we need to make adjustments in our theology. And I think a lot of pastors have a hard
Oh,
time.
it's just like the Pharisees and Sadducees, because then they might lose their place. It's all about a job. They don't want to lose their job if the sheep rebel. They don't expect the sheep to follow them. That just tells you what they think of how they get along with the sheep.
I'm speechless. I really am. It's the truth. And I think we owe it to the Lord. We owe him the honor of allowing him to change our theology.
Hello.
or to correct our theology.
It says in the prophets that the Gentiles are going to come and say, we've inherited lies and things that do not benefit. That's in the scripture.
Wow. That I actually find that terrifying. We want to know truth. We want to,
Ex yeah.
because we need to look, we're in the last days and we cannot waste time.
Exactly. We're in the last quarter, the last minutes of the last quarter. And just like in Hosea chapter 5, going into verse 6, the Lord said he's going to come, he's going to destroy Judah, then he's going to return to his place, and then after 2 days, Israel will come back, and then the third day, we will live in his sight. That's the millennial reign. Jesus died in 30 AD. 2030 is 2 days, and 2030 is when the tribulation could begin. Do we want to, go be with him, or do we want to be here through the tribulation?
That's a valid question. What do you want to do? People need to make up their minds and not be on the fence anymore.
I think that's what's going to happen over the next 4 years before the tribulation begins. God is going to erase the gray area. No sitting on the fence. You're going to have to get on one side or the other. That's what's coming.
Amen to that. I agree with that wholeheartedly. Pastor, I would like for you to close today.
Sure.
I think we've covered a lot of content today, enough for people to think, meditate, and pray, and prepare for what's coming. I'm sure that I'm going to invite you again and again and again and again. So
That's great.
we will hear more from what the Lord puts in your heart. But what would you say to the audience before we close?
Don't fear, don't be afraid. That's the main thing. Think hearing about things like this, you might be afraid. But yes, we have to trust in God. I've literally almost died a dozen times with guns at my head a couple of times, almost eaten by lions in Africa. I mean, you name it, major car accidents. And I know if it's not my time, it's not going to happen. And when it is my time, there's nothing I can do about it. So my main focus is, God, don't take me out until I accomplish what you've wanted me to do.
Amen.
And the main thing is trust in God. We have to trust in him and listen to his voice. I would be afraid if I didn't listen to his voice. But if you listen to his voice, there's nothing to fear. And that's the main thing. No fear.
Wow, what a message. No fear. Whatever comes, if it's not our time,
It's not going to
nothing
happen.
we'll survive.
Exactly.
We'll survive. I am so grateful that we could have this time with you to
Thank
hear
you.
the wisdom that the Lord has given you. And he has entrusted you with an amazing ministry to teach the nations. And I bless you today, Pastor Mark. And I
Thank
thank
you.
the Lord for your life and for everything that you're doing. And I will definitely get that Bible.
You'll love it.
Yeah, I am sure that I will.
You
So
have to let me know
yes, I
what you
will.
think of it.
Yes, I will. So thank you so much for being with us
You bet.
today. And for our audience, I pray that you pray and that you stay close to the Lord and that you share this podcast with people that may not understand or maybe have fear in their hearts after the election. Not everybody was happy with the results, but it's not about Donald Trump. It's about what
Right.
the Lord is doing on the earth at this time, at this
Right.
particular time.
Yeah.
So, be blessed, and we will see you soon.